Morning church. So it's just me and Nimi today. We're just going to do a little kind of acoustic set. But if you guys will just stand with us and worship, we'll get started.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. As if He did all of every victory is yours. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, for you overcame. Awesome and powerful forever. Awesome and great is your name. You overcame. Power in him, speaking the Father's plan, sending us out, light in this broken land. All authority and every victory is yours. All authority. Awesome and powerful forever, and awesome and great is your name, you overcame. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, you overcame. Awesome and powerful forever, awesome and great is your name, you overcame. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Testimony, everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, for you overcame. Jesus, awesome and powerful forever, awesome and great is your name, for you overcame. Worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, you overcame. Praise the one who set me free. hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living I've come to know. You, my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. Victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise.
Lord,
eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. I will rise. I will
Father, we thank you so much for Jesus. We thank you so much that this is not the end. We thank you so much that the future is so much different than now. We thank you that Jesus has purchased that for us and he is going to deliver it. Lord, I thank you for these young men. I thank you for Julian and Joel back in the booth. I thank you here for Alex and Nimi. And Lord, we're just blessed to have young adults who can step in when the regulars are not available, and we just thank you. Lord, be with us today. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Lord, you're the strength. You're the Redeemer. Lord, fill my mouth that your people might understand truth and be set free from things that are not you, but on the other side, we may be lined up that we may war with you in heavenly places for your best to be done in this nation, in this state, in this community. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated. As you noticed, our worship a little different today. And I'm so blessed. It can be different. We are just so, so blessed. Most of our worship team is still out of town. Bill and Pat are back, but they're doing grandchildren's graduations and all kind of other things. And yet God gives us a dynamite duet. That was way cool. And then back there in the booth, we've got Julian and Joel, and they have just stepped up, and it's just amazing. What a troubling week. I know your hearts have been broken. My heart's been broken. So many of us have just been blown away that 83 miles from here, at Robb Elementary School, 19 fourth graders, that's 8 to 10-year-olds, and two teachers were shot to death. And they were shot to death by an 18-year-old who first shot his 66-year-old grandmother, who was really the only family he had that cared about him, in the face, and goes to Robb Elementary School and locks himself in a classroom with two different sides and kills 21 people. Hides in the closet, and when the SWAT team comes in, he comes out of the closet, guns blazing, hoping to kill more people, and ends up being killed. That's tragic, absolutely tragic. And so what I want to do is I just want to shine God's word on it. I've often said I don't write messages, I receive them. I literally do. I ponder, but I think God speaks to me. And this is not one I was prepared to give. This is not one I've ever given before. And I just think God has laid out for me, Gene, I think he's laid out like 15 verses that he wants us to hear, and that we've got notes in the back if you want to grab those. But here are just the truths. And first off, it wasn't God that did that, and it wasn't even men that did that. It was Satan that did that. Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have it abundantly. Satan came to steal and to kill and to destroy. He was the first murderer. The first thing he did in the garden when we saw him is he killed Adam and Eve. He lied to them and he literally got them to commit suicide. And it's interesting how many of these shooters commit suicide. It's demonic. It's a demonic deception. It's demonic. Peter said that the enemy, the devil, goes about like a roaring lion, seeking people whom he may destroy and devour. A guy sent me a text this morning that I hadn't even thought about, but he said, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. It's not really about flesh and blood. We wrestle against principalities and powers and mights and dominions, against spiritual wickedness in high places. What's going on in this country is demonic. What's going on in this world is demonic. It's demonic. Jesus spoke to it. Jesus said that at the last days, the world would be filled with violence. Now, how did he say that? Well, in Matthew 24, he said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man. And then he goes on, he says, basically, they're going to be too busy for me. They're going to be marrying and giving in marriage, and just they're not going to think about me. But he said, as it was, and it's completely, it's the idea as it was thoroughly, as it was in detail. And so you go back to Genesis, and it says, the whole world was filled with violence, and God was totally displeased with men because they had brought this violence. And of course, I think they were operating under Satan. But the whole world being filled with violence is one of the conditions that will occur just before Christ comes. And of course, what we saw isn't the only violence. There have been 27 school shootings in 2022, 214 mass shootings in the United States. And you can go back, Columbine School, 2012, 26 dead. Parkland, Florida, 2018, 17 dead. The El Paso Walmart shooting a couple years back. You can just, it's a spirit of violence. There's a spirit of violence in this country. There's been something like 214 mass shootings in this country in 2022. It's just, there's a spirit of violence, and it's prevalent in this country probably more than anywhere else. Now, here's the deal. When Christ returns, that's going to stop. When Christ returns, that comes to an end. You probably have read this verse, and it's always quoted wrong. Have you ever heard, lion will lay down with the lamb? He won't. He could. But the scripture says that the wolf will lay down with the lamb, and the lion will lay down with the young calf. And guess who's going to be their shepherd? A young child shall lead them. Children 8 to 10 years old, like these who were murdered, it's going to be so peaceful they can shepherd lions and wolves and all the other little animals that we think about shepherding. Revelation 21 through 3 tells us why that's going to come. When Christ returns, there's going to be a strong angel come out of heaven, and he's going to take Satan, and he is going to bind him with a chain that Satan cannot break. And he's going to open the key to the bottomless pit, and he's going to drop Satan into the bottomless pit, and he will be bound there for 1,000 years. And the Prince of Peace will bring peace upon this world. God knew what happened. I think it broke God's heart just like it broke our heart. But he's not some far removed God who does not know when tragedy happens. I'll get to it in a minute. I think God weeps, and I'll show you how. But God knew. Jesus said, there's not a sparrow that falls to the ground that God doesn't know about. And be encouraged, you're of great value, much more value than a sparrow. And so God knew. I also want you to know that God understands. Have you thought about this? 19 children are murdered. Can you imagine what the parents feel like? I can't even begin to imagine. But God knows what they feel like. His son, who was absolutely innocent, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil, his son was murdered. He was so mistreated that it said if you looked at his form, it was more beaten and destroyed than any man's. If you looked at his face, you wouldn't even recognize who he was. And the father saw that. At the end of the movie, The Passion, there's this great big tear that comes out of heaven and breaks right at the foot of the cross. And I think God weeps. And I think he understands what every parent there understands. Those children were in about an hour to an hour and a half of absolute torment, horror, chaos, His son was in 15 hours of that. And I think he felt every bit of it himself. So we have a God who understands. We also have a Savior who understands. He knows what it's like to be murdered. He spent 15 hours being murdered. He was wounded and punctured. He was beaten beyond recognition, battered. He was punished. He was scourged. He was hung on a cross. 15 hours. He understands what those children went through. He felt it. He understands it. And then we had one of our church members, Simon, who, when that happened, he went to Uvalde. Bless his heart. And he went to the memorials and he went to the prayer gatherings and he just wanted to do what the Bible says. The Bible says, weep with those that weep. And he went and he wept with them. Jesus weeps over the death of people. When Lazarus had died, he wept. He comes into Jerusalem and he sees that in 70 AD the Romans are going to level that place. And he weeps. Do you know the Father weeps? You know who he weeps through? Isaiah says, God says, call for the weeping women. Call for those women who know how to mourn, that they might cry tears for us. If you've been weeping this week and you yield yourself to the Spirit of God, I think you're weeping in loving identification with the parents and grandparents. But I think you're also weeping in identification with God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. He says that these women might cry tears, and I love these things hidden in Scripture for us, for the Trinity. And so if you have been prompted to weep this week, I would just say, God, may these be godly tears. May these be tears that you hear. May these be tears that give help. And then I believe those children, I believe all 19 of them, between 8 and 10 years old, I believe they went to be with God. And here's why I do. David had a son, and the son was sick from birth, and he fasts, and he calls out to God, and he asks for that child to live. The child doesn't live. And when David realized the child doesn't live, he gets up, and he washes his face, and he eats, and his countenance changes. And the servant said, Lord, when the child was sick, but he was alive, you were mourning, and now the child has died, and you're not mourning anymore. And he said, it's because of this. That child cannot come to me, but one day I will go to him. And I do believe that children who have not come to an age where they understand sin, they understand the things of God. We used to call it the age of accountability. I believe those children go to be with God. And I think these children went to be with God. You say, is there any place in Scripture for their salvation? Yeah. First John 2:2 said that Jesus is the satisfaction for our sins, for those of us who have believed. But he's also the satisfaction for the whole world. And that doesn't mean the whole world is going to be saved, but I think it does mean there is provision for children. You say, well, that was just a baby. But yeah, but that was a baby conceived in sin. That was not a baby coming into this world perfectly clean. David committed adultery with that baby's mother. And then David tried to deceive that baby's father to thinking it was his. And when he couldn't do that, David sent this guy's death warrant in his own hand back to the captain or the general of the army and had him killed. That baby was conceived in sin. But that baby went to be with the Lord. I think that's what happens with children. And so this is the picture that I got. And it is of help to me, and I'm not a super softy who tries to make up little things that make us feel better. But this is the picture that I got. Jesus welcomes children to his lap. Some moms bring their kids because they want Jesus to bless them and to touch them. And the disciples say, don't take up his time. He's got more important things to do. And Jesus rebukes them. And he says, let the little children come to me. And I think he takes them on his lap. And the scripture is very clear. He lays his hands on them. And I think he speaks prophecies over them. I think he blesses them. And I think what happened with these 19 children is I think they went and I think Jesus took them on his lap. And what do I think he did? I think he wiped away every tear. And I think for those children, there's no more sorrow. There's no more crying. There's no more pain. There's no more death. I think that hour and a half of absolute hell that they experienced has been washed from their minds. And they don't remember that anymore. And there is no more crying and screaming. There is no more pain. There's no more sorrow. There's no more death. I literally think those went to be with the Lord and he took them in his lap. And I think one by one he wiped away every tear. The Bible says God himself will wipe away every tear. And there will be no more. That to me that means it's removed. There will be no more sorrow, no more pain, no more crying. And then, you know, I think what something like this happens, we want vengeance. But it's not our place. The Bible is very clear. God says, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. We're not in the vengeance business. We're in the forgiveness business. We're in the restoration business. We're in the helping people business. But God will judge. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord, I will repay. Revelation 20, 11 through 15, they stand before the great white throne and the books are opened and God brings forth judgment. And there will be judgment, but that's not ours to carry out. God will judge. So what are we to do? Philippians says that we will live in the midst of a wicked and perverse generation. And it is to be so, so, so black and so dark and so ugly. What are we to do? Well, we're to shine as lights in the middle of that. Light shines best in the middle of the deepest dark. And so we are to shine as stars, is what it says. We're to shine as lights in the middle of the darkness. Well, how do you do that? Well, you do what Simon did. You go down and weep, or you weep here. You pray for parents. You pray for those children that are wounded and have not passed away. You give. And I want you, there is a GoFundMe account for the victims of Uvalde. And if you haven't given, I'd like you to go there. And here's what I'd like you to notice. Some people on that account, the teacher and her husband who both died, have got $2,500,000 given. And some of these little kids who are from poor families have got $10,000 given. So I'd like you to go to the GoFundMe account, and I'd like you to find those kids that have got the least. And I'd like you to give to that account. And then it never hurts to give blood. They needed a bunch of blood there, and you can go to the blood bank and designate it for Uvalde, or just designate it for any. If you're O positive, your blood is gold, and it can be used in almost any situation. And so you can shine in the midst of darkness. What else can you do? As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the coming of the Lord. Well, guess what? This should say Hebrews 11:7 if you want to make a change, if you've got notes. But it says, Noah built an ark to the saving of his family. In the middle of this violence that God is so sick of, he's fixing to wipe out the entire human race, Noah builds an ark to save his family. So how can you build an ark to save your family? Well, you can build a truly Christian home. You see, this 18-year-old, he didn't have a family. And I think part of the reason why he was so unhinged was he didn't have a family. There's no mention of his father at all. They may not even know who his father is. From what I read, his mother was a drug addict and she was not in his life at all. All he had was a grandmother, and because she tried to put some fences around him, he tried to kill her. But I think broken homes make broken people. And so one of the best things you can do is don't have a broken home. Have a godly home. Have a Christian home. Men, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Raise up your children in the joy and the teaching and of the Lord. Don't do it as the mean motor scooter, as I'm the commander in chief. It says do it in a compassionate, loving way. I discipline my children a lot and high standards, but they were able to receive it because there was no doubt that I loved them. Protect, provide. Wives, cause you and your husband to be in unity. Respect your husband. Love your husband. You are the one that sets the atmosphere in the home. Nurture your children. May your home be places when people walk in, they want to stay because there is just a sense of God there. That comes from mom in the home. Work with the dad and the training of the children. It's the moms that read the Bible stories at night most times. And children, obey your parents in the Lord. The other thing is build into your children, love your neighbor as yourself. Build into your children the attitudes that we should have. And then this is something I do every day. Ephesians 6:17 says, put on the full armor of God. And above all, take the shield of faith wherewith you can quench every fiery dart of the evil one. Every day, as I've told you a million times, I die, I have a funeral, I ask God to live through me, and then I put on the full armor. God, I take the shield of faith, put it on my, guard my heart. I take the helmet of salvation, guard my mind. I take the belt of truth, guard my innermost being. I put on the gospel shoes. Give me a hope in the future. Give Gateway a hope in the future. And above all, I take the shield of faith. And I quench every fiery dart of the enemy. I quench every plan of Satan today against me, against my wife, against my daughter, against my sons and their wives and their children. Every day I pray for Laura. Every day I pray for Samuel Singh's wife. Every day I pray for Robert and Rosemary because they've had such a rough 2 years. And any others that God, but I just take that shield of faith and it says I can quench every fiery dart of the evil one. And so I just seek to quench every plan of the enemy against my family and my church family every day. And then consider putting your children in hopefully a safer place like our school. I don't think we're as big a target. We're small. We're inconspicuous. Consider putting your children in a in a safer place. Also a place where if your child is troubled, he's not going to be ignored. He's going to be helped. We've had some real ringtail tutors brought to us. We've had some real kids with problems brought to us, and we don't put them in the corner and forget them. We love them. We seek to love them into the kingdom of God. They have a place here. They have a name. They belong. I think it's a safer place. Teach God's values in the home, not the world's, and we've talked about that. Control what your children see and play. And figures don't lie, but liars can figure. And you can find as many studies on this on totally opposite sides. But I can't help but believe that children who sit here and blow people away in video games don't have their inhibition to blow people away absolutely destroyed. And so, parents, control what your children see and what they play. You sure don't want to have a killer out of your family. And I think that's one of the important things. And then control who they hang out with. Friends have tremendous power over children's lives, and online friends. You know, this guy was sending back and forth what he was going to do to some girl in Germany. I would control what my children see. I would control their communication, and I would control their friends. Basically, bad friends corrupt, good friends build up. And then this is important. Reach out in love to any potential shooter. When you see somebody and they're messed up, man, reach out. Know their name. Give them a hug. Tell them they count. I think we should do that as a congregation. Anybody who comes and visits this church, that's a divine appointment. They didn't come here by accident. They came here because there's something in them that is crying out to God. And so I beg you and plead with you often, when this service is over, don't run to your friend. Run to that person that needs a friend and see if you can build some kind of a relationship. And then this is the last one. Pray for a move of God in Uvalde. Word of God says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, God, by His Holy Spirit, will set up a battle flag against him. And so let's pray for the town of Uvalde, that there might be a move of God there. You know, I kind of bought into this narrative that you hear, you know, a sleepy little Texas town, little friendly place. I had an elders meeting Friday morning, and because of people out of town, we had six there. And we were just talking about this message and wrestling with it together. Three of the six gave me bad reports about Uvalde. Said it's a rough town. They said they would go with Somerset to a football game and there'd be fights and people in the stands would get abused. And Sean said they went on a camping trip in a beautiful place near there, but they rented it for two nights and they left after one because it was a bad place. And so maybe this is a wake-up call for Uvalde. Maybe this is a time where we need to pray. We need to say, God, send revival to Uvalde, Texas. Send revival to San Antonio. Send revival to Gateway. Send something to bring good out of this horrible evil. And so those are the things that I've got today. Does some of you have something you'd like to share? Yes, Pat.
Children that were evacuated. But the look on most kids' faces. how he was singing.
Yeah.
And then say, you know, why am I spared? And hoping that God will speak to them. Mm-hmm. I pray for those that survive.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you pray? Pray for us.
God, we just lift up those kids that survived and those that are hearing this story. Father, to help them, Father, give them people to comfort them, people to understand. Father, help them to have a heart that says, you left me here for a purpose. So Lord, I survived.
Amen. Thank you, Pat. Anybody else want to share this morning? I sure appreciate y'all being here. And this will be online on our YouTube site. And if you want to have somebody else see it and tune in, be sure and let them know, okay? Father, I thank you for Jesus. I thank you that he's the Prince of Peace. And Lord, yet we're living in an age of violence, and Lord, I pray we would be light in the middle of that. Lord, help us to love when the cameras go off and the TV station's not there. Help us to know what we can do personally. Lord, if we could do something as a church, we're available, Lord. I know there's a lot of money and a lot of things going in there now, but God, if there's something you want us specific to do, but Father, we do pray for the parents of these victims and the grandparents, and I can't imagine the loss. God, I do pray that you would somehow comfort, but also cause people to think about eternal things, and Lord, may some come to you because of this. We pray for the children that survived, and I, like Pat, I can't imagine, Lord, they want to sleep with lights on and doors open, and it's understandable. But God, I pray you'd pull down every stronghold of the enemy. And God, somehow you'd bring their thoughts captive to the obedience of Jesus Christ. And Lord, I pray that you would give them help and hope in the middle of an agony and horrible death and defeat. Father, I do pray for you to raise up revival. In Uvalde, I pray that there would be a move of Christ, of the Holy Spirit. Lord, you said when the enemy comes in like a flood, you would cause your Holy Spirit to raise up a battle standard against him. Holy Spirit of the living God, please go to Uvalde and raise up a revival. Raise up a spiritual awareness and a spiritual influence and a spiritual atmosphere far beyond anything they've ever known. God, may revival break out and may it pour into other places. And Father, we just cry out to you and Thank you, Father, that we're not left to our own thoughts in times like this. Thank you that we have your word. Thank you that your word does help us and balance us. And Lord, I pray that we would just be focused on your word as we process all of these things. Lord, we ask you to take the video of this service and to spread it around to those who might be helped by it. And Father, we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.